Hello and welcome to Legally Speaking with me, Tarun Nangia. Today we are going to discuss the non-performing asset, or widely known as the NPA issue, and the roadmap ahead. We are also going to discuss that whether there is a need to distinguish between who is a genuine defaulter and who is a willful defaulter. And is it right to label them with the same brush? On the one side is a businessman who has honestly taken risk and due to downturn in the business environment, he's suffering problems. On the other side is a businessman who's deliberately taken loans, created subsidiary companies abroad or in India, siphoned off those funds, done gold plating of costs. So there is a need to distinguish. And how should we do it? We will get to know from our panelists today. We've got a very eminent panel. I have got Mr. Gopal Agarwal. He is a director in the Bank of Baroda, a qualified chartered accountant. Also, he is heading the economic cell of the Bharatiya Janata Party. We also have Advocate Gaurav Gupta joining us on the show today. Welcome both of you. So sparing your time and joining us on this issue of this episode of Legally Speaking. I'll start with you, Mr. Agarwal, your opening comments on this issue.
What you have raised, Mr. Tarun, that's very important. NPA is a very serious problem. It is bogging down the whole financial institutions, specifically public sector banks. And they are under extreme pressure because of accumulated NPA that have been identified because of several policy changes at the RBI, then some disclosure norms with regard to Ind AS, Basel III norms. Also, all these have, and the government policy on coming out clearly identifying all kind of NPAs, and then second thing after identification is the provisioning on that. So that has created a big pressure on the balance sheets of the public sector banks particularly, and other scheduled bank also. But the important question out of this is what you have raised, Mr. Tarun, is all NPA, if they are classified into a single entity and dealt with in a similar manner, it will further aggravate the problem. We have to segregate NPAs into various categories. Though the gross NPA is one factor, provisioning is one factor, but down the line, NPA should be segregated into three areas, where how they have been generated. There is a genuine business risk involved, also business failure because of risk in the business environment, some policy changes, all these things cause sometimes failures in the businesses, and that is one important portion on the NPA. Second is the portion which has arisen due to crony capitalism. What is being generally debated in the channels, etc., is a crony capitalism arising through the nexus of politicians, through the bank officials and corporate houses, which had been going on under the, basically it is considered that last 10 years under the UPA regime, there was a lot of crony capitalism which has resulted into accumulation of several NPAs and over leveraging, which we call the twin balance sheet problems, which was flagged off in the economic survey last year also, which the PM has also flagged off in his speech some 5-6 days back, that twin balance sheet problem has resulted in a very difficult situation for many corporates, and it is because of over leveraging of debts, low equity capital, low profitability, and loans from the public sector bank. And the third important aspect which we see in today's debate just now, whether it is Nirav Modi, PNB bank fraud, it's a category of fraud. Due to fraud because of the fraudulent employees of certain banking institutions or some other associated institutions. Mm-hmm. So that is because of fraud. Some category of NPA is because of connivance of these.
So this is the third category, which is a totally fraud category of NPA.
Yes.
I'll come back to you. Gaurav, I want to ask you, has the time come now in India to distinguish between a genuine crook and somebody who's suffering due to genuine downturn in business environment?
Tarun, it's very, very difficult, although there is a need. It's extremely difficult to distinguish as to what constitutes a genuine reason and how do you identify or pin down as to what is a genuine reason. That's one. The law on willful defaulters is very clear. A willful defaulter is someone who has the capacity to pay but does not have the willingness to pay, or has taken the loan facility for a certain reason, but has not utilized it for a certain reason, or has diverted the money elsewhere. As Gopalji rightly put it, crony capitalism, your corruption nexus between bank officials, politicians, all that is a big issue. Although another issue, a very distinct issue which I want to touch today is, these issues about crony capitalism nexus are but a tip of the iceberg as to why willful defaults happen. The main reason, one of the major reasons why we don't look at this problem, how we don't look at this problem is because of the lack of a national litigation policy and how the government conducts its litigation. The manner in which government conducts litigations against private parties, corporate houses, has run thousands of corporate houses into despair, leaving them with nothing but abject poverty. What happens is, if you were to recover money from a government institution or a government body or the state or the central government, it will take you 20 years because right from the district court, the government has the capacity to fight it till the Supreme Court, which will take you 20 to 25 years. So if a corporate is to recover money and its money is blocked for 20 to 25 years, imagine the plight of that corporate.
That's a very important point Gaurav has raised, that the government
and unfortunately, no government, including this and the previous government, has its focus on initiating or working towards a national litigation policy, because the government constitutes 60% of the litigation in our courts.
Government is litigious by nature.
Yes.
It likes to litigate.
Now, Gopal, I want to ask you that, was there an effort any time in the past 10, 15 years to solve this problem? Because today, if accumulated loans are, say, 8 lakh crores, just to put a number to it, did it happen in 1 year or 2 years? It would have taken 10, 15 years, because loans are not given by the lakhs of crores. Loans would be given in 400 crores, 500 crores each time. So is this a result of what happened in the past 15, 18, how many years, I don't know. But could you just, you know, tell our viewers that when and how did this happen?
It's very important that if we want to solve any problem, we all agree that the problem of NPA exists in our financial institution, particularly bank. But we have to understand what is the genesis of the whole problem. Has it arisen suddenly, or it has accumulated over the years? What has led to this large figures being now put in the balance sheet of the public sector banks? That is very important. Ultimately, what happened was that when the current government came in 2014, there was, if you see how the debt component of the corporate houses increased over the last 6 years before 2014, we will divide the whole period pre-2014 and after 2014. From 2008 to 2014, you see the debt component from the corporate houses increased manifold. It increased from 15 lakh crore, the debt component in 2008 rose to 52 lakh crore in a period of 6 years. The second thing was, when current Modi government came to power, the calculation with regard to NPA, at that point of time, out of that 52 lakh crores was and the same figure now being analyzed and calculated on that figure has increased 2.5 times. No new loan, but the NPA calculation has risen from that figure by 2.5 times. That shows that somewhere there was a problem of identification. The identification of NPA was not proper. The mechanism through which the banks were identifying NPA was not transparent, and there was some amount of evergreening.
Before I move to Gaurav, I want to know from you, in these 6 years, when 37 lakh crores of loan was given to corporates, do you think these loans were given with some malafide intent? Was there some corruption or some give and take in those loans? Because in the end, the common public would only understand what? That were questionable projects given these loans, or questionable corporates who had no intention of turning those projects into reality? What was the reason for giving out these loans? Were these reasons bona fide?
This is an important aspect to be analyzed. But practically, that shows, points out to what you are saying, that so much of large quantity loans were given between this 2008 to 2014, and out of that, the identified NPA in 2014 to 2007, current 2017 increased by 2.5 times. That shows that those loans were substandard, sub-quality loans. The asset created against those loans, which are kept by the banks as collaterals, were substandard assets, and they did not generate the same level of economic activity and profitability in the corporate houses to service their debts. They over-leveraged their equity. They took over loan because of easy availability of debt or because of nexus or easy financing that the banks went ahead. Either it may be because of political pressures to some friendly corporate houses that got a large quantity of loans without proper collateral securities being given to the
banks. So you're linking it to political interference in loan giving?
Definitely. That shows one point, because two factors have to be very clearly identified. The quantum of loan in last 6 years of the UPA increased from 15 lakh crore to 52 lakh crore.
That's abnormal.
Yes, that's an abnormal in 6 years. And from that identified NPA, out of that exposed loan or disclosed loan, from 14 to 17 increased by 2.5 times. That means that the NPA, which is now being disclosed, which you have also said that 8 to 9 lakh crore, has not arisen from 2014 to 17, but it existed in 2014, but was not identified. After that, RBI, Ministry of Finance, and international organization like G20 or OECD have put pressurized the government to bring in more transparent norms with regard to NPAs, and those processes have now resulted in very clear identification of what exists at present, the NPA component out of the total loan which the PSU banks are exposed to. So that is to be very clearly understood, and that has resulted into genesis of this twin balance sheet problem. Another aspect which also needs more investigation is that the capital formation figures during the last five, six or 10 years of UPA was given to be very hefty because of investment by the private sector. Somewhere down the line, we have to also analyze is that capital formation was just a public money being transferred to the corporate houses in the debt component, and they investing into projects. That's a capital formation figure which is on the ground reality was not a healthy capital formation in the private sector. That's an important point also to be considered.
Three very important points raised by Gopal Agarwal. I'm going to Gaurav. Gaurav, now I want to understand from you three things.
Yes.
He spoke about the loans increasing from, say, 15 lakh crores to 52 lakh crores. So, 37 lakh crores given between 2008 and 14. Now, do you believe that this is only a result of nexus between banks and industrialists, and this needs to have been cracked down and that oversight was not there? Second, when this government came to power in 2014, legally, do you think they had a chance to present a white paper saying that so much of exposure is there and we don't know how it happened and something needs to be done? Or do you think this missed the system because there were not enough checks and balances to detect that these loans would turn NPAs in future?
Tarun, you're absolutely right. The first part of what Gopalji addressed, and he related to a crony capitalism, nexus and huge spurt in loans. Obviously, there is something wrong. However, it's not a problem which is so simplistic. Obviously, for an economy which is growing, you need to be lending to the banks. And I don't entirely subscribe to, today we have these social media vigilantes and armchair activists who, any corporate who has a big loan, they'll say that this corporate is a chore. Now, we have to realize in a democracy, you have to trust someone. These corporates, along with the farmers, are one of the spinal cords of the country. These people are running the country. These loans, which you castigate so openly and casually, are the loans which go on to create lakhs and lakhs of jobs. So don't paint every corporate with the same brush. Having said that, that's the answer to the first part of your question. The second part being, this government also, in all fairness, has not taken enough steps, as is evident now that Vijay Mallya has run away and this other gentleman, Nirav Modi, who's also run away. All of these could have, it doesn't matter in whose era the scam emanated, these could have been either stopped, or these gentlemen could have been stopped from you know, leaving the country because the government was there. So it does not justify, it does not behove the government of the day to say that they've been taking enough measures. I don't think personally enough measures have been taken either by this government or the previous government to crack down on the problem of NPAs and willful defaulters, which is just what is in public domain, is just a tip of the iceberg. If the actual figures were to come out today, the entire Sensex would crash, I would imagine.
Okay, that's an important perspective that Gaurav is giving. On this note, we'll take a short break and we'll be right back. Welcome back. Just before the break, we had got Mr. Gopal Agarwal and Mr. Gaurav speaking on the genesis of the NPA issue, the ways to tackle it. I'm going to Mr. Gopal Agarwal. Mr. Agarwal, I would want to know from you that this whole NPA issue, as it is, how will it affect the governance at financial institutions? That's part A of my question. Part B, after this government came to power, could a white paper have been presented? Then, has the current steps which have now been taken by the government towards resolution of this problem, now that they know that this problem is there, weaken the financial institutions of the PSUs? Will it strengthen them because so many problems have now been found out? And third thing, I'm just adding a supplementary, that if 37 lakh crores of loan was given, they say after 2014, banks are not in a position to give those loans more. So no loans were virtually given after 2014, no loans were given. Does it mean that all these loans given up to 2014 are now causing a problem? That loans were already given up to 2014 and now the problem is arising because after 2014, lending virtually stopped. Yes. How do you see all this?
No, these are very important. We have discussed on the genesis. Now, what is the current government doing? Because we have to move ahead. Economy, yes, has to move ahead.
Yes.
And it is not that India only is having the problem of NPAs. It's across the globe also. Many banks, China has a bigger problem than us. We also have some large quantity of exposures that has come as a substandard assets, or that has created substandard assets or low quality loans. And there are some people say that more can be exposed because of exposures with regard to this housing loans, which are considered to be secured at present, but actually if the flat is not, possession is not given to the house owner, then they become unsecured. And then there is a exposure of banks in the NBFC categories. Then somewhere down the line, we are talking of enterprise value, then group exposure. These are all issues much more which can create some minor deviation in the NPA figures. But I think largely the figures have been identified with regard to NPA. Second important step for the roadmap ahead is that over 3-4 years, banks have been pressurized into provisioning on those NPAs. And almost 40% provisioning has been created on the gross NPA. And net NPA is around 5.5 or 5.6% of the total exposure. So that in itself somewhere gives a comfortable strength to the banking sector. Another, this problem was identified when we came to power, and we had to tackle this problem. Problem existed, genesis we have discussed, but ultimately it is our government which has to solve and strengthen the financial institution. It's our responsibility. So we studied on what the steps earlier government had taken to resolve those NPA earlier which existed, or was there a concerted effort on the part of the government, earlier government, to resolve these issues. So one thing was the identification process was not fair, what not transparent, and there was evergreening process which helped them into putting them below the carpet. So this process was streamlined so that evergreening etc. is stopped. All banks have to clearly disclose their loans with regard to whatever loan they have an exposure, and then identification of groups which are risky groups, which are considered willful defaulter or other things. Those efforts on behalf of RBI has now created a transparency in the balance sheet of public sector banks. And we should also understand that 90% of the loans are belonging to corporate houses, are belonging to 27 of the PSU banks. So this is also an important issue why public health of public sector bank is very important for our economy. Government also wanted to accumulate information, put in the structure which will reform the system, put up a roadmap so that resolution it takes place, and slowly and slowly banks go for more provisioning, and even demonetization helped in strengthening the bank because they got a better chunk of deposits.
Yes.
So that they also the liquidity problem that they were facing has also been checked under the demonetization issues.
Okay. Gaurav, I want to know from you this the insolvency and bankruptcy code was brought last year, and now it's working well. Do you think it was much too late? It should have been brought in 2012-13 when we had indications that these companies, the health of these companies are not doing well.
Tarun, that's right. But law being the dynamic creature it is, it's always better late than never. And that's how law evolves. We learn from experience. It's a societal experience. Amendments to law, manifestations of our societal experience and having gotten our fingers burned. So I would only say better late than never. I wanted to make a very quick point.
Yes.
See, building big business houses of multi-billion dollars is all well and good. It's needed. But Sabka Saath and Sabka Vikas will not happen unless you give access to funds to every person sitting in every nook and corner of India to execute his or her own ideas. Now, this government and our Honorable Prime Minister had conceived a very novel idea, and it's very laudatory, about Startup India. But my experience of having interacted with various startups tells me how choked they are when it comes to getting funds from banks. And it's not easy for startups to get funds from banks. And this is where holistic development will not happen if you keep pushing up a few business houses. Having said that, the contrary experience is completely different. This is the sentiment that you reflect to the middle class. Whereas a very great expose was carried out by your channel on NAFED.
Yes.
Now, NAFED, it's an organization for giving loans to farmers,
yes,
whereas it had given loans to the tune of 3,000 crores to some private shell companies,
yes,
without any justification, without any collateral,
these
without
kind of,
any paperwork.
Kind of,
and then they wrote off 2,000 crores of that loan and entered into an OTS of some 400, 500 crores with them.
So this
and
points
arrested
out to some kind of a nexus.
Absolutely. What is the message that you're giving to corporates and startups?
That's an important point, and you raised an important point. So I take this as your closing comment. Mr. Gopal Agarwal, your closing comment, and we have to end the show. We are running out of time.
Yeah. I think we have discussed on the genesis and the what is the policy of the current government on this. We have to in detail see what earlier efforts were taken by the earlier government to resolve these issues and how effective they were. With regard to there was SDR, structured debt restructuring, then there was CDR, credit debt restructuring. Those issues, why they failed and why they were not successful in resolving the issue. One thing was those were financial instrument, structural financial instruments where they were utilized more for evergreening,
yes,
recycling of loan, not resolving the loan,
therein
rise not recovery
problem
of the
so evergreening
bank loan
is a big problem.
Yes, and all these instruments, if you go into letter of undertaking or letter of credit, which we see in Nirav Modi case or Geetanjali Gem case or other thing, or if you go on any debt restructuring tribunal cases also, where they those instruments used, SDR or CDR, all were helping
I'm
evergreening.
I'm taking this as your concluding point for today's episode. Most important point that we got to today was evergreening of loans. Evergreening happened just to hide the NPAs. Evergreening was simply, you can say, painting with the brush to hide the problem. We're done with, we are concluding the part one of the NPA Genesis issue. We'll soon come back with a part two on this issue. But thank you so much for joining us on today's episode of Legally Speaking. Thank you.